This game is called Dots and Boxes. It's played by children in many places. I learned it in the first grade in 1946. We're gonna play a game, and if you don't know the rules, you'll soon learn them as you watch us play. We have a board here. When we end up, we'll have 9 boxes, and when it's your turn, you can make a move. I'll make the first move like this. It's your turn, you can join any 2 dots that are adjacent, horizontal or vertical, and it's my turn, I'll make a move here. You can play anywhere you want. Now, the goal of this game is to make more boxes than your opponent. The rules are, if your move makes the 4th side of a box, then you get to fill that box in. It becomes your color, and you own that box. So we get scores depending on boxes. Okay, so now I make a move. Well, I just made the 3rd side of the box, so Brady, if he wants to, he gets the 4th side of the box, and he puts his initial on that, and he owns that box. That's Brady's box. It's 1 point for him, but he takes an extra move now. He gets a bonus move for having made a box.
And he has to move as well.
And he must move, that's right. Now you'd think, well, go ahead, he'll make a move, 4 and 4. Looks like I may get 4 and he may get 4, but we'll see, that doesn't quite work. So I go here and I make this box, that's 1 box for Elwin. I go here and I make another box, that's a box for Elwin. Now if I wasn't a very bright player and I was sort of a beginner, I would continue making 2 more boxes. And then I'd give him the last 4, but I'm smarter and I give him a play here. Now, I've completed my turn without making boxes, so I'm done. It's his turn now. And whatever he does, if he goes there, it's called a double cross. That's probably his best move. And he makes 2 boxes on 1 turn, yeah? But he gets only 1 extra move. But having made boxes, he gets an extra turn, but now he has to take the extra turn, give me the last 4. And so I win this game by a score of 6-3. So every time I make a box, I get an extra turn. And we go on like this. And so the score is 6 for me and 3 for him.
Did I lose because you're too good for me, or did I do something stupid?
You lost because we got to a point here where there are 2 long chains. And a long chain, here's a chain of size 4. Here's another chain of size 4. And the number of chains was even. 2, and that's why you lost. This little one is a chain of size 1. It's too short to matter. Long chains are very important, and a long chain is one that has 3 or more boxes in it. The first player wants an even number of long chains, and the second player wants an odd number of long chains.
How could you control the number of long chains?
Well, I couldn't if you'd have played really smart from the beginning. But you had a chance even fairly late. If you'd have cut one of these chains into 2 short chains, then there'd have been only 1 long chain and you'd have been okay. The second player strives to make an odd number of long chains, and on this board he can do it, and I'll explain how. And the first player strives to make an even number of long chains. A key feature of this board is there's only 1 center square. And if we look at this at the board, we can decide, okay, there's some moves over here in the corners. It's called these corner moves, right? So we have some corners. We have some sides. We have 4 sides, right? And we have some centers. There's 4 centers. And we have some spokes. And these moves are, okay, that's all the moves there are. If you can force all long chains to go through the center, there will be only 1. So any chain that not go through the center necessarily has to be a side chain. So for example, let's just look here. What is a side chain? A side chain is a chain that goes off on some side, see? So this. In the first game I played, he went something like this. Now I'm threatening to make a side chain over here, see? Haven't done it yet, but it's tempting. So we got something like this, something like that, something like this, maybe here, and I now have a side chain. This chain is 1 chain, there's another chain here, so there's gonna be 2 chains, which means this is gonna be a win for the first player. Now, the second player could have won, and the key to the second player's winning is to stop the side chain. And the way to do this is to play spokes. These are the moves you want. I prefer to do it in a swastika pattern, so that these particular moves, this set of moves is very good because they stop all side chains. There's no way that any side chain can be made. So let's look at it. Suppose the first player starts like this. The second player should think, aha, he's threatening to go and make a side chain over here. Or at least get started, and then there'd be very hard for me to stop it without sacrificing something. So I'm gonna break it up right away. I break it. I stop that chain from coming into existence on that side, right? So he goes over here, maybe he's threatening another one. No, I play another spoke. I play one of the swastika spokes. I play it perpendicular to his last move, usually right adjacent to it if I can, like this. And now he can't make any side chains over here. So he's in bad shape. He will never get a second chain.
What about, Elwin, what about the top and the bottom? Can these be, do they count as side chains?
Only if he can make a chain, but how's he going to make a chain? If he tries, watch, he tries. He tries this, see? But I stop that too. Second player goes here. So now that we have two little chains, they don't matter. It's only the big chains that count. And so there isn't. Now maybe he succeeds in being no chains, which would be good for the second player in the end game, but the only way he can make no chains is the sacrifice. He might do that. He might give away two boxes right now. But if that's the case, there's no chains, the little stuff will all get divided up evenly, and I'll win on the sacrifice.
On a game that is four dots by four dots, or three boxes by three boxes,
yeah.
Play second, play the spokes, and you will definitely...
Play the alternate spokes as in a swastika. You don't let him get center and a side adjacent to each other. Because if he does that, that's a threat to run a chain through here. And the only way you're going to be able to stop it is to sacrifice a box. Don't give away any sacrifices until you have to. Stop the side chains right away by playing the alternate spokes and play them adjacent. Whenever he makes a center or a side, he goes and moves in the corner. That's no problem. You just let that move be. If he plays a spoke, fine. That's we like. The more spokes, the better.
Should we play a game and see if I can beat you now?
Okay, off I go.
So immediately, the danger to me here is you playing
yep,
there.
That's for sure.
So I want to make a spoke?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
All right.
Great idea. Okay.
Now, again, that's good for me, but from what you told me, that's my danger now?
Yes.
So I want to make another spoke?
Yes.
All right.
Oh, Lord. I have no hope anymore.
This early in the game, you're thinking, I now have no hope.
True.
Now, again, this is my danger.
Well, first of all, there's a box. And if you don't take that box, I will. Okay. Now there's threats on both sides. Does that scare you? Why?
Well, because even number of chains gives you the game.
Yeah, unless they're all small. So you can stop there from being two. Just there are two threats now. You stop one, the other is only going to be one.
So sure. I play here.
That's fine.
And these have both become small chains.
That's right.
And now we're back to only one
big long, chain.
And that's good for me.
Or maybe zero. I mean, I can make zero chains. But since you're already 1 point ahead, that's right. That's right. You get both of those, right? And you give me two. And and I give you two, and you win. Normally, and actually you got 6-3 because I sort of...
I played Elwin Berlekamp at Dots and Boxes. Only after he taught me exactly
what
to
do. Tell you, the proudest thing a teacher ever does is when he gets students who are better than him.
This video was filmed at MSRI in Berkeley, California. But perhaps fittingly, for a video about Dots and Boxes, it's also been sponsored by Squarespace. If you're looking to set up a website or a blog or an online store, I really recommend Squarespace. In fact, I recently got fed up with my own blog and I've started using Squarespace and I wish I'd done it a long time ago. It's really enjoyable to use. They've got these great startup templates you can start building with, but then customize them as little or as much as you'd like. Really usable, really good customer service, and importantly, the websites you make on Squarespace automatically look really good, well, on big grown-up computers, but also on your handheld devices, your mobile phones. Now you can just go to the site, have a look, you can even play around and build your own site. No credit card details or anything like that, just see what you think. And then if you do like it, and I think you probably will, you can get 10% off by using the code NUMBERFILE. It also lets the people at Squarespace know that you came from here. In fact, you can just go to the website, squarespace.com/numberfile, find out the rest from there. As I said, I use them myself. I'm a really happy customer and you might be too, but regardless, thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this video about, appropriately, Dots and Boxes.